I'm Roland Thomas. I'm going to give a little 10-minute thing here. I just have 10 slides to introduce the afternoon session of the early user or new user training today. So most of the talks today, or all the talks in the afternoon, are going to be about the data ecosystem at NERSC. So first four talks are going to be all about how to store and access data in various ways at NERSC. And then we're going to have a couple of talks about sharing data, either through data transfer or through this thing called the Spin Early User Program. It's going to talk about Science Gateways a little bit. And then a little bit about analytics, because Python and Jupyter are pretty important part of the data ecosystem. And then at the end, we'll talk about workflows kind of in Shifter. Okay. So all these talks are just 20 minutes. I think there's one 10-minute talk, and there's obviously this break in the middle there. So not too bad. In a single day, we can't really cover absolutely everything in the data ecosystem, so we kind of have to pick and choose which things are probably most important for new users to know about, and then kind of point you at the documentation and the other tools that we have so that you're at least aware of those. So I'm going to give you a few pointers to things that we're not going to be covering in a talk today, and kind of give you a sense of, like, you know, what we do here in terms of this data portfolio or this data stack. So part of our job is to know about various technologies and figure out how to deploy them for users. And so that means that we do a lot of adaptation of these technologies so that they work in our, you know, create ecosystem. We kind of draw these kind of semi-arbitrary boxes around what these different pieces are, but they're kind of split up into data transfer and access. So you'll see, like, NX, because that's accessing stuff at the center, kind of next to Globus. Managing workflows, data management, and then there's pieces in there that are also kind of analytics-y pieces. Data analytics, which is kind of this really broad topic about just doing stuff with data, I guess, and then data visualization. So today we're not going to talk too much about data visualization or workflows quite so much, but I hope that wasn't like I said something really silly or something, but I probably did, but... So anyway, you know, there's a whole bunch of logos here, and, you know, if you see something that resonates with you, then you should feel good, and if there's something that's missing here, then you should feel bad, I guess, but, or you should talk to us about, you know, why don't we have that, or maybe we do and we just didn't have it here. So CORI is kind of the first system that NERSC has run that brings together HPC and data into a single system. So I think this morning we heard a talk where we talked about all the different systems, and we talked about how CORI has these two partitions, the data partition, which is the Haswell partition, and then the HPC partition, which is the KNL partition. Doesn't mean you can't do data analytics on KNL, but it means that you kind of have to do a bit more to optimize your code to get the best performance that you can out of it on KNL. But Haswell is sort of the data partition. Most people doing data analytics are running their stuff there. On the Haswell partition. CORI is also special because it has all of these kind of nice features that are really friendly to data analytics and data processing users. People who are doing anything with data, like processing data from experiments or looking at simulation outputs and doing something with that. But there are a lot of things that are kind of more forgiving, I would say, to those kind of users. We have like twice as many login nodes. Not all of them are available for users, but we use some of those other login nodes. We repurpose them to do other things. We have a couple of nodes for running big memory jobs, which are kind of important for data analytics. Special nodes that are set aside for pipelines and workflows. CORI is the first system where we've been running containerized environments in production. So that's going to be the last talk today. We also have ways of streaming data to and from the compute nodes, configurable access over the network to the compute nodes from outside, which is kind of new. We also have this burst buffer. There's going to be a talk about the burst buffer and how to use that for storage and I/O later today. And then we have this really flexible workload manager in Slurm. We switched to Slurm a few years ago, and it's given us the ability to field some kind of more experimental queues, like the serial queue, the shared queue, a transfer queue, real-time queues, and then the interactive queues. Have you ever used the interactive queue on CORI? If you haven't, your life is about to change. Check it out. It's really awesome, okay? And of course, we have a node specifically set aside on Query that's a repurposed login node for running Jupyter notebooks, okay?
Wait, so what does the interactive queue do?
Immediate access to compute resources on Query. So there are some guidelines around how many people can use it from a project and how many nodes you can have, but it's a life-changing experience. I'm not exaggerating. So a few of the things that that I wanted to touch on that we're not really going to have time to go over today in a full talk. I think I have like five of these things. One of them is, as I mentioned, we have this really flexible workload manager called Slurm, and we're able to configure special queues in it for different use cases. And so one of them that's probably of interest to people who are running experiments remotely is the real-time queue. This is on-demand access to a pool of nodes that can respond basically immediately. As soon as you want to run a job, you're able to do that. And it's you have to apply to get into it, and it's mainly it's four experiments that are running at the same time as they need to do the compute, but they don't have the compute resources on site to do it. So it's shipping data over and then doing something with it and shipping the answer back. Newt, if you ever wanted an API to talk to a high-performance computing center, you've got it on this slide. You also have a slide where every word in the title is an acronym, I guess, which is kind of cool. But Newt is a programmatic interface to be able to enable you to script doing things at NERSC in a nice and easy way. So if you have a web browser or you want to write like a Python request script or something like that to automate some kind of workflow, you can do that with Newt. And there's a little link on all of these slides, I think, that you can follow up on. Science gateways are hardware where we run user-written web applications that enable access to users outside of NERSC to data that's at NERSC, and these can be completely public or maybe in your own collaboration or something like that. You can use it in conjunction with Newt to provide interface to HPC resources like launch jobs and things like that. Deep learning is a topic that's extremely popular. We're not going to have a talk about deep learning or machine learning technologies at NERSC today. Maybe later on in the fall at another training event, we will. But we have a variety of tools supporting machine learning. We work on optimizing those tools so that they work well on our HPC hardware. And we hope to be in a conversation with our users about deep learning and machine learning to encourage the use of cutting-edge methods and finding projects to collaborate with. So, and then last but not least is data visualization, kind of the most popular simulation, visualization tools that are out there. We support Visit, ParaView, and the in-car graphics library. But we also provide support for visualization tools that aren't quite so heavyweight, or maybe are Python libraries or something like that, or R libraries, or if you really like GNUplot, you absolutely can use GNUplot, YT, Root, and then specialized tools that are kind of domain specific, like the visual molecular dynamics. All of those things are available, and if there's something here that you need, we can look into installing that for you. And then at the very end, it can't be emphasized enough that if you're doing Viz at NERSC, you should really be doing it over NX. Okay, so that was like just a quick set of slides of talks we're not going to have today. And so the next talk that we're going to have is Lisa, and that's going to be on our file systems here at NERSC. And then, are you ready? Okay.